Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Kochi Biennale Foundation, I welcome all of you, and also NS Madhavan sir and Mr. Ashis Nandy. In fact, we are very honored to have them in the city today. And we also have with us eminent artist Padma Bhushan Ghulam Muhammad Sheikh with us. And we also have Professor Roby Rajan from Wisconsin University with us, and also Maya Joshi from Delhi University among us. And we also have Jitish Kallath, the curator for the 2014 Kochi-Muziris Biennale. And we also honored to have N. Madhavan Guti and Mr. Das, the eminent journalist, as you all know. And we also, again, on behalf of Kochi Biennale Foundation, I welcome all of you to this a very famous Let's Talk series, which we started almost a year before the Biennale began in Cochin. So today's conversation is like very much dear to the organization. Why we must speak of cosmopolitanism, of hospitality, of coexistence? Because in the current context, every day around, as we see events of violence and enmity, of hostility instead of hospitality, of conflict instead of coexistence. It is from an imperative to respond to this difficult world that the Kochi-Muziris Biennale was conceived. And it is in the everyday and the everywhere of the city of Kochi that we found the resources to think about and act for ways of coexistence that are more peaceful, more just, and more creative. Because Kochi and its legendary predecessor, Muziris, have played host to numerous communities who have come here to trade, to find refuge, to proselytize, to work, to conquer, and also they have stayed back. In today's world, where diversity is considered a threat to be managed, Kochi's communities live together in and through diversity. This other cosmopolitanism of Kochi is the premise of Kochi-Muziris Biennale. Today we have Ashis Nandy, an eminent sociologist and cultural commentator who has successfully problematized the dominant concept of India's political culture like development, secularism, progress, and colonialism. His major books include, as you know, The Intimate Enemy, Traditions, Tyranny and Utopias, and The Savage Freud. And also we have N.S. Madhavan, is an author of acclaimed Malayalam short fiction collections like Higuita, Choolaimedile Savangal, Thiruthu, and Paryaya Kathakal. He has also written one novel, Lanthan Batheriyile Luthiniyakal, which you all know that it's about Kochi. Ashis Nandy, in his essay on Kochi, spoken of this other cosmopolitanism that is alternate to the currently dominant model of coexistence that domesticates and annihilates differences. At the same time, N.S. Madhavan, as in his novel Lanthan Batheriyile Luthiniyakal, given us a fictional picture of the modes of living in Cochin. Kochi Biennale Foundation's Let's Talk series is aimed at providing a direct access to the public, to scholars, artists, historians, to encourage discourses and debates. The Kochi-Muziris Biennale 2012 celebrated the multicultural legacy and cosmopolitan aspects of this region. Another cosmopolitanism continues the legacy of Kochi-Muziris Biennale while also providing us an alternate insight through these two great minds into what could be. Again, welcome all of you. We hope we're going to have a very intense discussion between Ashis Nandy and Madhavan. Welcome, sir. Thank you.
A very warm welcome to Dr. Nandy. Actually, this is supposed to be a conversation, but I'd be refraining mostly from talking because I've been around here, I am around here, and Dr. Nandy is someone very rarely visits Kochi, so we'll all be looking forward to hearing him more. And he had done this essay on Kochi, the other cosmopolitanism, which speaks of an alternate model to cosmopolitanism. And in his various visits to Kochi, he had come across what Kochi is actually. Every person has a personal history, his own history of Kochi, his own theories. So I'll start my conversation with a small personal history of mine. My father was a Government of India officer who used to work in Kochi, and he had three other colleagues, and they were all together for about 30 years together. Their children and we played together, and their names were Xavier, Mohammed, and Kohed. And years later, it occurred to me that this looks like an Amar Akbar Antony kind of story. There is a Christian, there is a Hindu, is my father, Kohen, who one of the last white Jews of Kochi. He just passed away about 4 or 5 years ago. His widow is still there. And Muhammad. So now this self-consciousness, I think that spells the death of cosmopolitanism. I think this is where it starts. You know, we all had a childhood in which we used to make crack jokes about other communities. We used to call them names, but now there is a polite silence, there is a political correctness, and we are all aware of this, the identities. Probably this could be the silences could be the end of cosmopolitanism, or could be the beginning or the end of cosmopolitanism, not only in Kochi but elsewhere. I think a very eminent person who can take on this will throw us some light.
Well, frankly, eminence has nothing to do with what I'm going to say. But I will also start, perhaps in response to you, with my personal experience. And I have told this story many times. But before I do so, I want to make one point very clear, that the Indian middle class has very unwittingly but enthusiastically swallowed a concept of city and village which is contrary to the experience of not only India but probably the global experience with cities. It is this, that all serious students of urban life now accept that city is not a late development in a civilization, and village is not an earlier form of habitation. City and village emerge simultaneously from early times. There are two kinds of living habitats, and from the beginning this difference existed. This is very important because most of us believe that what is village today will become city tomorrow. ultimately the city will dominate the world. But this was not, this has not been the experience of humankind over the last at least 3000 years. And if you think, you will quickly notice that our earliest signs of civilization were found in Mohenjo-daro and Harappa, and they were cities, not villages. So that is an important point to remember, because under colonialism emerged a different concept of the city, and that is a concept with which the middle class Indians, the educated Indians like to live, namely that the city is urban, city is more civilized, city is more open, more cosmopolitan, and the village is backward, and the fate of the village is to become a city. In fact, colonialism went further, because it had these three metropolitan places with which it started, Calcutta, Bombay and Madras. Therefore, they built the cities in a way that, as if the definition of the city was that, the ultimate, final definition of city was this, that a city is that which is not a village. It is a total negation of the village. Village, therefore, became the depository of whatever is backward, dark, unacceptable, strange, alien to our rulers, and the city became something where some semblance of civilization existed, and so on and so forth. It is that colonial city's model, the model of that colonial city, that we live with nowadays. And part of the problem is that traditionally, the city and the village were separate, and but always in dialogue. The village always criticized the city, and the city always criticized the village. If you don't trust me, read Shudra Michakatika, you will see. Read the dialogues and you will see that the villagers make fun of the civic, the residents of the cities, calling them too clever by half, calling them sly, calling them scheming, and so on and so forth. And the urban characters criticize the village as something which is uncivilized, crude, barbaric, and so on. So all 19th century theories of social reform and political reform, you can call it political change in general, went by not Shudrak's kind of dialogue and cross criticisms, they went by the colonial concept of the city. When Marx called the village a sack of potatoes, or idiocy of village life, he was articulating the spirit of his age. And that has stayed with us. I came to Kochi because Nilan Thiruchilva, the Sri Lankan political activist, politician, and humanist activist, requested me to mobilize a study of Kochi because he knew I didn't know Malayalam. He said, you find a person who will do this study and you supervise it. But the persons I tried to work with, most of them ran away. They were very bored with my kind of exploration of the city, that there is a man who goes and talks to people. And what is there to study in that? It's like getting life histories of so many people. Ultimately, I had to, with some help with others, do it by myself. My first experience with the city, which I had heard people say to me here, had not seen an ethnic or religious violence of a serious kind, one or two skirmishes here and there, for previous 3000 years, That is difficult to prove because the history of 3000 years is not available to us. But we did check, I did talk to some people, and we found that for the 600 years or odd, that some records were available, good, bad, indifferent. It showed that there were no serious conflicts here of either religious type or the ethnic type. I said good enough because I have been studying religious and ethnic violence for the last 45 years. And I started my work. I was trained in a psychoanalytic clinic. Sociology is part of my interest, but it is psychoanalytic sociology which is my real interest. I started like any other enthusiastic person, randomly choosing people from different communities. And I found that indeed, Kochi's population would clearly pass all tests on good citizenship. Because when I asked them, why do you think there have been no such serious violence? They said, oh, because we are all secular. Why there is no violence? Some said because we are progressive. Others said we are not violent because literacy rates here are so high. We are educated people. Then we don't fight like the uneducated ruffians. The closest I came to a little personalized answer was this, that some of them also said we are not like the North Indians. That's that. So I gradually learned to ask, okay, I have understood that part of the story. I would like to now know something more about your life, your childhood, your school, who were your friends, and so on and so forth. And they began to tell their life stories. I usually interview people for days, till I get some semblance of a biography. I cannot do a full biography, but it is nevertheless. And I gradually found that in Kochi, no community liked other communities. Nobody liked others. After a while, after they are tired of saying the good things, they began to say, but so and so once did this to us. But they have been helpful to us, but their women were not educated. We taught them how to, influence them. Our influence has persuaded them to send women to schools, and so on and so forth. Nobody liked anybody. Alas, Cochin's marvelous cosmopolitanism was based on mutual dislike. But I did find two factors which I thought might be relevant. First, that I found nobody in Cochin, none of the people I interviewed, could describe Cochin, could talk about Cochin without invoking the other communities. They couldn't tell about their own life stories without other communities. The landscape of Cochin for them was always full of multiple communities. And we also found that while they thought, each community thought it was the best of the lot, and others were inferior or flawed, I also found that they knew that others thought the same of themselves. And they were ready to gulp that. So that was the nature of cosmopolitanism Cochin had. In my essay, I have called it epic culture. Because Indian epics, gods are never all perfect. not the demons, all demonic. And the interaction between them is a very human interaction, where along with enmity, there is also very subtle element of attraction and distance. It is that which remained in my mind. Gradually, I began to find out, because I had by that time taken more interest in genocides, comparative genocide studies, as well as studies of the 1947 partition violence. I found there too that what I had seen at Kochi was perhaps not that unique. Perhaps coexistence and co-living, if you might call it so, can be defined the way marriage can be defined. That's why the comparison I usually give. I was giving this example to somebody only a few days ago. A good marriage can be defined by how few quarrels the husband and the wife has. But I remembered my friend philosopher K.J. Shah, after reading Erickson's famous book on Gandhi, said the concept of marriage in your discipline, psychology and psychoanalysis, is flawed, because marriage cannot be only judged by how much quarrel you have. Gandhi and Kasturba constantly fought. So that doesn't mean that it is an unsuccessful marriage and a bad marriage, which Erickson used to, you know, hint at. A good marriage can also be measured by the fact how many quarrels it can take. So, I was moving to a different concept of cosmopolitanism. I was moving to a different concept of cosmopolitanism where more radical diversities can be taken into account. And ultimately, when I was doing my study, which was a much larger study, by that time, because this was going to be the last probably possible empirical study, actually on ground, study of the partition violence. So we interviewed roughly 1,500 people, at least 200 of them in great intensity and depth. I found, first of all, that there was a very large proportion of people who reported that they were saved because or helped to survive by somebody from the other side. 40% of the respondents said that they were helped. These are mostly people who had run away from Pakistan, because at that time the regime didn't allow me to, I had a huge grant. They didn't allow me to transfer the money to Pakistan and Bangladesh so that I could get study of the conflict there. But I did get help and some association and some case studies from them by the Pakistani and Bangladeshi friends. But we couldn't do it in this case. We found that 40% of the people have received help from the opposition. I defy you to find any genocide. Show me data from any genocide anywhere in the world which comes even close to it. And I wanted to ask what was it that happened. Because people had died trying to save. The survivors themselves saying, people who have lost half their family said that this Muslim bhai accommodated us. And when they came and began to kill us, they also killed him because he was hiding Hindus. Or six. And if you think this was the case only of Muslims and India, in our study joined a Pakistani friend of mine who had come to the same issue, because he had accidentally found out the experience of a similar kind in Pakistan. He found out that he was moved to this to the study, because he had gone to visit a family whom he knew, and it transpired that that family had a woman who was abducted by the Sikhs. And that woman was returned by the family of the boy who abducted the young Sikh who had abducted him. And she told the story that when this young Sikh who had gone in with other friends and abducted so many Muslim girls took this woman home, his old father told him, "Son, this is not permitted by Sikhism. Our religion doesn't permit it. Go back and give the woman back to her family." But he has seen his friends abduct women, and many of them they married, by the way. So he refused and left the girl. The father took out from the mantelpiece, the sword, sacred sword, and killed his son and took the girl back to her family. So he said, "When I heard this story, I began to look for similar cases. I have already found more than 100. I propose to you that these stories have something to tell you, and I can give you many stories of this kind. These stories have something to tell us. I mean, our people, I would like to propose, first of all, do not need our advice and our theories and our concepts to learn how to be hospitable. They do not have to go by textbook concepts of tolerance and secularism and the whole galaxy or gamut of them. They have their own principles, often grounded in their own religions and faiths. I am not a believer, but I have to respect that, whether I believe or not." I don't want to take a long time, after all this is a conversation, but if you wanted, I would very briefly end with a story which shows the other side of it. You know, that how this alternative, this deeper relationship survives. There is this woman who has lost parts of her family, has been displaced in her 80s, and she remembered with great nostalgia her childhood. She used to play with her neighborhood Muslim girls. But her family, particularly her mother, used to beat her up if she ate at their place. So she one day went to her friend, this Muslim friend's play, mother, and said that, "I have a problem. I come to play with your daughter and my family is quite happy with it. They don't mind it at all. They enjoy it. But if I eat at your place, they beat me up. But I like the food at your place more than I like the food at my place." So she said, the mother said, "Okay, that's not a big problem. I will solve it. Do you know any Hindu mantra?" As it happened, it was probably an Arya Samaj family, because she knew Gayatri Mantra. He said, "I do." I said, "Okay, then it is no problem. I am teaching you a kalma. I am teaching you a kalma. You mug it up. And when you come from your home to my place, recite that kalma. By the time you arrive at my place, you become a Muslim. So you can eat anything here. And when you go home, you recite the
Gayatri
and you become a Hindu by the time you go home. But you don't have to say this to your family. Now, I propose to you that this other form of tolerance is can tolerate more radical diversities than the standard concept of cosmopolitanism, which is inspired by the Enlightenment values. So it is very narrow. What you tolerate in others, what you are expansive towards, what you want to build your fraternity is on, is based on a shared set of values. You expect others to also conform to that. This other kind of cosmopolitanism I am talking about does not make the presumption, because it does not host your sameness. This is the thing now, Subcommandant Marcos says in Japasistas. The Japasista motto is, you must learn to host the otherness of others. You must not learn to host the sameness of others, but the otherness of others. That's their motto. And I suggest that there I found something of that in Kochi, and probably in elsewhere in the non-colonial cities of India. Still you will find, even in cities, but otherwise in the villages. I have studied ethnic and religious violence all over the place. I have studied Ramjana Mohi movement. I have talked to many people who have tried to save it. But I try to look at the potentialities of our people. I know there are many flaws, and everybody finds flaws with them. But my job is not to do that, because I come from a clinical background, I have a clinical gaze. I want to look at the potentialities of people. I don't want to cite off a people just because their potentialities are low, like a doctor does. Doctor has to still try to save the patient, even if his health conditions are very poor. He doesn't say, let us not waste resources and forget this patient and divert these resources to another person who has a better chance to live. So that's the way I look at it. And I would propose that this other kind of cosmopolitanism, I began to call it Silk Road cosmopolitanism, because my suspicion is this is the way that earlier cosmopolitan style went. And I think our people have not lost the capacity to live with radical diversities. And we have the arrogance and the pretension to like to teach them. I think we have something. By the way, if I may point it out at the end, in the last 65 years, if you look at the number of dead in communal violence, religious violence only, 94% of them have died in cities where is only 30% of the people have lived in cities all these years. If you take a rough average, it is now more than 30 at when we were independent, it was 20. But 30% of urban India has produced 96% of the casualties dead. And 3.6%, I think, have died in Indian villages. The arrogance of going to teach them tolerance is unacceptable. Thank you very much.
Well, Dr. Nandi's exposition just triggered a few thoughts about the history of violence in Kochi. Kochi had sporadic violence, had major violence. I think the transition between Portuguese and Dutch on a Saint Bartholomew Day saw thousands of people killed by the Dutch Presbyterians. And in modern times, as you rightly pointed out, in my memory there was only one major religious clash in Kochi, that was in 1968. Yes, more than a skirmish between not Hindus and Muslims, between Muslims and Christians of the coastal area in Kochi and Waipin. It was mostly a commercial kind of thing, because the fishermen were all Muslim, were Christians, and the traders were Muslims. Probably that conflict took the shape of a violence that went for about, a low intensity violence went on for months. Then the other experience was 1984. We have a very small community of Sikhs here. They have a small Sikh Gurudwara here. It was destroyed. Actually, they had to hunt for Sikhs to find out, to commit violence on them, because that's a kind of revenge that was probably called upon from them. Well, again, the spirit of Kochi, the Gurudwara was rebuilt with the help of all the other communities also. Now there is a third kind of, I won't call it violence, it's a kind of, well, it's a violence at one level. We speak about migrants coming to Kochi, when the Shankle had visited, Chinese have come, Jews have come, Thomas Akana has brought Christians. The last and the most major migration to Kochi or to Kerala is of the Biharis, Assamese, and the Bengalis, which has been completely neglected or given the death by ignorance. Every Sunday, it's a sad sight to see all these migrants from Kochi and nearby. Their major place is a place called Perumbavoor. They all come to the boat jetty here, take a boat, go to the park in Fort Kochi, spend the day without talking to any of the local. They have just shut them out of their lives, and without them, we cannot also live. So this is a kind of silent apathy which is being practiced. Then there was another history of violence which went before Riyas and Bose took Kochi's name to abroad, to all the world capitals. In 1952, the major labor strike was in Cochin port. And the shooting there, there was solidarity, there were strikes in Berlin, in Paris, and all the places where the old Comintern was powerful. So there is a history of sporadic violence, and probably the decline of the radical coexistence is most evident now, because the way we are dealing with other Indians in Kochi, this is a thought that just triggered by your exposition.
You know, this study I did 20 years ago, Kochi also has probably changed.
Then another thing which occurs to me is the evolution of Kochi, how in the pre-colonial times, if you take any map, world map of the ancient times, all the trade routes didn't end in Kochi. It ended somewhere much higher, in Gujarat. I mean, they had much more to offer, copper, textile. Spices was a later fad. So, I was wondering whether it is why both the places took a very divergent post-independent independence life when both had a shared history. Actually, Vasco da Gama was probably brought to Kochi by a Gujarat by a Gujarati navigator. So when you have the similar kind of history up to a certain point, and a sudden schism, a sudden rupture, and one going all hoggedly to a majoritarian as of now, other, as you have rightly portrayed, still maintaining elements of cosmopolitanism.
Yeah, For that, there is one possible. No, I'm not giving obligatory dictas. Possible explanation is this, that I have found during my work on genocide globally, that the genocides take their most gory, cruel and disturbing form, inhuman form, when it breaks out between communities that are not strangers to each other, but which are very close to each other. And then for some reason the relationship has ruptured. That's where it becomes really cruel. I was telling somebody only today, I think, that in Rwanda, the Belgians mobilized an anthropologist to write a report on the two tribes, Hutus and Tutsis. And he failed anthropologically to distinguish themselves clearly. So in his report, he also wrote that I am giving this ways of identifying them. But the best guide probably is this, that anybody who has more than 5 heads of cattle is probably Hutus, or what, I forget who. Hutus. And if it's less than 5, then it is Tutsi. They were so close. It was difficult to identify them, separate them culturally. I can say similar things about Bosnia. The Bosnian Muslims and Serbs, 30% of Bosnian Muslims have Serb relatives through marriage. I can give the example of India, that in partition violence broke out in 2 states where the Hindu-Muslim relationship was some of the closest, Punjab and Bengal, and Hindu-Muslim-Sikh relationship also, Hindu-Muslim-Sikh relationship, Triumvirate, very, very close. And that is probably one of the reasons why also you find so many people come to the other side helping. But even there, I would say that there is something of the relationship that is very complicated. I think Gujarat is facing this now. I mean, Gujarat is a place where Hindus and Muslims were intertwined in a very complex and deep fashion. And I get to give you just one instance. Kishore Sant told me this story, that there is a young boy whom he was talking to after the riots of 2002. And after a while, Kishore asked him, "You must be very angry. You must be wanting to take revenge and kill some Hindus when you grow up." He said, "Humare liye to wo bhi mushkil hai. That is also difficult for us because we are Chiragi Muslims. It is the custom in our community, when going to our mosque, first light a lamp in the Hindu temple on the other side and then go to the mosque." There is this part of the story too. I could give examples of Ramjan of Bhumi also like that. But this is so that intertwining is almost like a joint family splitting and staying on 2 ends of the same road, each one keeping a tab on the other to find out how bad other is. And yeah, they have divorced but not got the other out of their system. For example, my friend Stanley Tarmaya, who studied violence in Sri Lanka, blames it entirely on democracy. He said, "I am not anti-democrat, but it was probably we needed other kinds of safeguards, because mobilizing for democracy and this idea of a majoritarian way of control over democracy, however much you might talk of other values which constitute democracy, ultimately that sticks in the mind of the people. But I will also add to it that it is not so much democracy, but the importation of concepts of the nation state, nationality and nationalism. Let me not beat about the bush. I think all three concepts are totally borrowed concepts. It is not that patriotism was unknown in this country. Patriotism is different. People have natural affinity to the land where they are born and brought up. Even cats and dogs also have that. Even pigeons have it. Some birds have it. The territoriality. But in addition to that, nationalism makes certain demands on it. And those demands, as Tagore recognized long ago, and became very unpopular because he articulated his ideas in Japan when it was in its highly nationalistic phase, as well as in China, that nationalism denies communities. In fact, nationalism in Europe was introduced and promoted by the elite because the elite were afraid that with the fall of monarchies, what will people identify with? Why should people be allegiant to the country when the king was the one who symbolized the country? So they promoted nationalism very systematically. The elite promoted it, but they didn't believe in it very much because they intermarried. They continued to intermarry amongst themselves, across the borders of the country. So they didn't believe in it, but they promoted it in the population. And we have purchased that model at a discount and paying the price for this cheap purchase. I think this is not a society of communities. This is not a society of nationalities. This is a society of communities. We have lived with communities for centuries. We know how to handle it. And we will continue to live at least for some more centuries with communities. But these communities are breaking now. And one of the reasons, my fear is this, that one of the reasons you see so much this violence, cycles of violence is this, that because we have lost the communities, we set up this pseudo community called a nation state. And that keeps it our uncritical allegiance. Wali Khan, Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan's son, when he was tried for sedition in a Pakistani court, he said to the judge, "My lord, I have been a Pakistani for 45 years. The case was earlier, pretty years ago. I have been a Pakistani for 45 years, a Muslim for 1400 years, and a Pathan for 5000 years. I know my responsibilities."
The other thing that is disturbing, probably the coexistence of community, is over aggression of all religions in the last a decade or so. Because in Kerala we have not heard of a festival called Athaya Tridiya till about 10 years or 15 years back. And when it started, we thought it was a commercial tactic by the gold jewelers. But no, it's a very deeply entrenched cultural festival now, Akshaya Tritiya. There's something called Bala Gopalam, where children are dressed up, say, like Sri Krishna, and taken through roads with blue paint, hot sun. I mean, it is real child abuse. So, so there's that aggression. And also, I had this experience about 3 days back. I stayed in Fort Kochi. About 10 years ago, I stayed in Fort Kochi. 3 days back, four mics were blaring from the mosques. 10 years ago, there were no mics. So aggression is met with counter-aggression. I mean, is this, I mean, this is must be happening in in Kerala being a place where things get amplified very fast, must be happening everywhere else. So, is this again, I'm going back to my pessimistic theme, the end of, the beginning of the end of cosmopolitanism?
Yes, it could well be. We might see another kind of India in probably another less than a generation. It is possible. But I would like to believe that our people have still the resilience and common sense, perhaps to retrace their steps. But I certainly hope. That's not saying much.
Well, here again, another thought, because I have this parallel experience of the most advanced state and the most backward state. I worked in Bihar for about 30 years. So, whenever an authority or a dictatorship, tendencies of dictatorship has come, it was always fought on the Gangetic plains. This is the only state that voted back Indira Gandhi after the emergency. So, that kind of also, for example, from Kerala, no one, no outsider has contested the elections. Even a non-resident Malayali like B.K. Krishnamenon, when he wanted to contest election, the major attack against him was he was not a resident of Kerala. Whereas in Bihar, a Malayali has contested and won the election, Mr. Ravindra Verma. 1951, Kripalani, latest, a Mangalorean, George Fernandez. So, I mean, there were more. There was, there's a lot of inward narcissism probably about Kerala rather than a true nationalist vision like the places which had gone through history, which had gone through struggles. This is a stray thought.
But do you expect this trend to accelerate?
I think by the...
diminishing?
It has already accelerated probably. I mean, we have... we have now Dinanath Patra here. Batra, I mean. So, who is going back to history. So, I mean, that rupture has probably started, and all we can hope for again is resilience of our people, past history, how we fought back. But this place, Kerala or Kochi, doesn't have that history. Probably because, I mean, there were no, the kings were more or less autonomous. There's a very famous Malayalam writer, Bashir. So Bashir actually wanted to have to participate in the independence struggle, but he couldn't do it in Travancore where he belonged to. So he had to go to Calicut because Calicut was a part of Madras Presidency and under. So there was a freedom movement going on in Calicut. Bashir took a train and went to Calicut to make salt. So this kind of... this kind of soft glove handling of by the history probably has made us more adaptive and less combative, like a Bihari or a UP fellow.
Do you think the fact that so many Malayalis now work outside, not only Kerala, but outside India, and this displacement, this very fact of losing touch with, because ultimately our religions are local. So you have not only family gods and goddesses, but your vernacular practices, your village gods and goddesses. So it is not that you have a very very clear-cut pantheon and so on and so forth. then suppose you are going and face to somewhere else, whether it is Dubai or even Assam, then and suddenly find that your Hinduism or your Islam doesn't make any sense to those people, and you are forced to depend on the classical texts, the Vedas and Upanishads, because you feel that you are not being accepted as Hindus, and so invariably you are sucked into a fundamentalist pathway, so a fundamentalist frame of mind. And do you think that something like, I'm just, you know, studied this, so I'm asking your opinion, now you have written a novel on this, that do you think something like that is happened, that this what we call Hindu nationalism is actually an attempt to find a pseudo community which doesn't exist, but which you have to imagine just to give meaning to your own life and your own identity, because there is no endorsement for that identity in wherever you are located. Is it possible?
I think this migration from Kerala has played a very important role in molding the religious opinion, because the majority was to the Gulf. The money flowed from Gulf. So also the religious ideas, because in my childhood I had not seen a uniform for the Muslim person. There were no hijabs, but now all of them, there's a uniform. They all are identifiable. That's one thing. Second is the import of ideas through about 4,000, the maximum number of RSS shakas are in Kerala. And to man them, the people from, well, mostly from Western India come. So they bring in that kind of ideas. So there is, well, due to this migration, there is certainly a toughening of the religious stance.
Can I make an observation on this?
Yeah.
I found in my village, in my people who go to the Gulf countries, before they leave, we see them as progressive, kind of people who are secular, that kind of thing. But after 10 or 15 years, they come back. And I found Muslim young people who have gone there, come back. They go to Jamaat-e-Islami and all those fundamentalist groups. They were never, I mean, they were not even religious before they went to the Gulf. They come back and then they try to kind of, I see it as like a, they announce their social or economic graduation through identification with fundamentalist groups. This happens in Kerala among Hindu communities. For instance, somebody who climbed, you know, kind of, we call it Vetua community, oppressed community, like, you know, Pulaya community, or, you know, the caste is a factor. There is nothing like a pure community as you imagine of pantheon. There is no Pulaya pantheon.
So there are
very cross-cutting things. It's not as simple as just one community anywhere. So there are so many things. But I have found this lower caste, let's call it lower caste, or Dalit family people going to the Gulf, coming back after 15, 20 years. Then their kind of attempt at social a graduation is to go to a shaka or to be connected with a temple committee, where you, who he never wears a bindi, comes and wears a kumkuma, and he comes along with the RSS or the BJP type to collect money from your house. He comes into an upper caste house to collect money for a temple along with a Hichak Hindu Parishad person. The other Muslim boy who was progressive, when he goes and comes and connects, tries to collect some money from a rich Muslim boy in the name of Jamaat-e-Islami. So there is a question of, that's why like the typical building of big buildings you are building, no? They're building these huge palaces to kind of compensate to kind of things. So I find the Gulf migration has reinforced religious communal identities. So there is a reinforcement of communal caste identities. We have to explain it not in terms of sheer ethnographic examples and broad brush things. The real fact is that Dalit communities are getting, kind of thing. So this is the reality, and this is a very horrid reality, this whole Gopalakokulam and Jamaat-e-Islami. So for instance, if you're Jamaat-e-Islami, there is a front organization called Solidarity. Solidarity comes to you for all kinds of donations. There are two receipt books. One receipt book for orphanages. The other receipt book is for conversion, or kind of, you know, people who are for helping those people who have come over to the Islamic fold. So this is kind of thing. So let us not be very, you know, neither the ethno-sociologist or the creative writer, because we are media people, we are day-to-day touch with reality. So you have to explain these intricacies in cross-cutting things.
Professor Nandy, I just wanted to share one experience in the aftermath of your essay. When I shared your essay with some other Malayalis, they were all inevitably critical of the essay. And the standard reaction was that, you know, that it wasn't a proper ethnography. Now, how could Kochi be isolated as a city? It's after all connected to Kerala politics, that you didn't really have a feel for, you know, the local conditions. The standard sort of secularly correct Malayali response that, you know, you didn't talk to the working class, you only talk to the elites of these communities, and so on and so forth, you know. So, but whatever this picture of a complete ethnography was, which is fiction, of course, I mean, what does it mean to capture a city like Kochi in its entirety, you know? So, on the one hand, the local had this idea that somehow the study that you did was not really complete. But on the other hand, it's your external gaze that captured the essence of the city. That is, I don't think that a piece like yours could have been written by somebody who was a local native, because it took that kind of distance, that outsideness, you know, to cut through all that sort of ethnographic crap and to capture the essence of what Kochi was like, you know. So I just wanted to say that, you know, sometimes truth in that sense can only come from a form of misrecognition, what appears as misrecognition or falsity from some idea of capturing the entire truth, you know. And of course, the fact that we've invited Professor Nandy today is a form of reclaiming that truth that emerged out of that misrecognition, you know. So sometimes it's the outside that captures the essence, and now we are reclaiming that kind of outside perspective as our own, and making, and the city of Cochin is now imbibing that outside gaze and making it its own. You know? So you know, often we think that it's the insider that has access to the truth of the place, and I think your fine essay proves the contrary.
In fact, frankly speaking, I accept the criticisms also, because I do, very deliberately I shared some of the other data we had. Like, for example, this long monographic length thing on the Hindu community and its history and so on, suppose it was done by Malayali. I didn't use it at all, because I thought that will mess up, because I am talking of this smaller community and that's a larger community. So I thought I will write this, and maybe some other way, some other day, I will use. That never happens and often. So there is that part of the story too. Let me not underestimate this. And but probably you are right that, you know, in all my studies I see that after I finish the study, the real questions come to me. But I haven't asked them when I was doing the study. Because you learn so many things. And only when I started religious bias, only when I've done my major works, I have now find that from Japan to West Africa, the coast of West Africa, none of the languages I know, and I've asked probably hundreds of people, serious scholars, have a word for religion. Has a word for religion. All words for religion are 19th century translatives from English. Dharma is not religion, everybody knows it, but we pretend as if it is. And what kind of religion it is? When the Mayo Muslims, the largest Muslim community near about Delhi, traces its ancestry from the Pandavas. An earlier generation I used to have, before this kind of Jamaat kind of influence came in, they used to have, their name indicated that. So it will be Riyaz, Komo, Deep Singh. That kind of name used to have. So these are also part of the story. Even today, Ajmer Sharif, if you go at a time when it is not a Muslim festival like it is today, then you will find even many days the majority will be non-Muslim.
So even Haji Ali in Bombay.
Haji Ali in Bombay. Even the Bombay's Mahim Church,
yeah.
Not more than 10% of the pilgrims there are Christian. And the Golden Temple, if it is not a Sikh festival, the majority is non-Sikh. So this still exists. It is like, we are like Japan and China in respect to some extent. In Japan, more than 90% are Shintos, more than 80% are Buddhists. It will be very difficult to organize a Shinto Buddhist riot there. In China, if you add up the percentages of Confucians, Taoists and Buddhists, it will come to nearly 200%. Because they overlap. So, we didn't have that phenomenon called what Protestant Christianity introduced in the world stage as a religion in the proper sense. So, because Catholicism was more open to other people. That's our concept of religion now. Everybody, every reform movement in Hinduism in the last 150 years have tried to make Hinduism more like
Christianity
and Islam. I mean, this is a strange one. So that way the Hindu reform movements, Gandhi once said, in the long run, the Hindu reform movements have done more harm than good to Hinduism. But this is the way. Because they have tried to produce a proper religiosity, Allah, Protestant Christianity, because that also, we have read Max Weber, we know the spirit of capitalism is derived from Protestant Christianity. We know that states must have nations to be states. We have land space, very large states. The Mughal Empire lasted 400 years, British rule lasted 200 years. Mughal Empire allowed differential allegiance to the state. Here we have to say we are Indians first, then Hindus. We are Indians first, then Sikhs. Otherwise people are very offended. Why should this be? Why this that emphasis on what comes first? At times when you are Hindu, you are Hindu. When you are Indian, you are Indian. There's no problem with that. There's no problem with that. I don't see any problem with it. And this delirium of nationalism which we are suffering from at the moment. I mean, it's becoming a real headache. And it is not only me. In China, the regime is nervous about that. They are also very terribly nervous about it. And they have gone back on their anti-Confucian posture during Cultural Revolution. Now all China Chinese language courses run by Chinese embassy are called Confucian centers. Confucian centers. Because they want to have a little bit limit on the national.
Cults become communities. Cult. A bhakti cult. For instance, we have got a very strong Amritanandamayi cult. It almost looks like a community in its reactions, in its hostilities, in its acceptance. It looks like unlike your traditional communities, they are very aggressive. So what do you think about the emergence? You have got this yogi with the RSS now and then, all kinds of people. How do these cults, these new age gurus and amadas and pitas and all, how they...
in our Albania, Americans go to psychiatrists or psychoanalysts. We go to gurus. many of them are do nothing but except get a false sense of solace, so to speak. Help you to live with yourself.
How do they figure in your ethnography?
I would not call them communities. They're cults. That is a different thing. By communities, I mean I don't know what you will call it, Malayalam, but in Sanskrit it will call Goshti. Collectivity, some kind. And these communities are intersecting, and there are overlying communities. So you can be Muslim, but you can be part of the present community in some ways. You can be, you can be part of a linguistic community as well as a part of a caste community. And, we have this mechanical way of looking at all these things. That's the problem. I mean, for example, I can give you one example of a community where caste is very important for the survival. The Manganias and Langas or other stars, the musical communities, they would have never been anything but a very lowly place. And they would never been acceptable to the Muslim religious establishment because of their music and nature of the music, had they not been designated as lower caste. They are left alone. They have been left alone because they are a different caste. So this seems to be. So there is that part of the story also. But there we are.
In Kerala, we knew that regarding the temples, the town, temple towns, the property ownership. We do have a long history of that, towns being developed out of this spirituality and all. Across India, this may be the same, and across the world, this may be in a historical period, this may be the similar thing. In Hindu religious ownership or property ownership, we call it Devasom. Devasom means something owned by the god or godly or temple. And there is this acknowledgement that whatever property, predominant property, that is being owned by the Devasam, this in the gradual course of time has been distributed or lost to some other communities. And this is being, as a status symbol, rather than the actual ownership, this is being talked about in the narrations, or when the memories are being told, this is being acknowledged. And the other communities generally talked about the way in which they have been converted. Basically, from when you think about a Christian community or other communities, they states that they have been converted from the Brahmins so that they can social status can maintain on their part. So this cross, what you say, acknowledgement regarding on one side the lost property, we had a lost what you say glory on the one side regarding the property, and on the other side acknowledgement of the caste that I have been converted from the Brahmin. This cross acknowledgement do create a sort of a social relationship, which I think may or may not, I don't know whether tolerance or intolerance in the fast. This is what I have.
No, I have a feeling this Devasam or the lands in the name of God is a proxy ownership. It probably stood for the best example is Travancore. The king ruled on behalf of Padmanabha. So, I mean, you assign your land to a god and you appropriate it yourself. I mean, there is no great mystery there. That's my feeling.
Impact of global warming on human sanity. Because by personal experience, I was a physics student. In 1967, if room temperature is not given in a problem, we are supposed to assume 26 degrees. Now it is 38 degrees, maybe, and I'm not in the college now. So 12 degrees have gone up from 67 to today. And I think when it is warmer, all particles move faster. So naturally, I think it has an impact on sanity, it has an impact on behavior. If you probably make a study on the basis of the ambient temperature, you may get that answer. More cosmopolitan, where the ambient temperature is probably tolerable to human beings. That's my feeling.
No, to the best of my knowledge, man.
I think it's a very interesting question because even the context of the biennial, I mean, when we're thinking about timing the project, I mean, we said, you know, that's the only slot available in the art calendar that December nobody has occupied because everybody is freezing, you know, who's mainly engaging in the contemporary art scene in the world. So I just want to kind of bring the, you know, conversation, you know, maybe a little bit back to, you know, engaging with the kind of larger audience story, you know, like because the biennial was also a plot for, you know, anywhere or anybody who had a kind of relationship with Kochi historically, you know, we were trying to kind of address that, and while addressing the first the initial year's concept itself of like celebrating the cosmopolitan legacy and the multicultural aspect, the amount of interest which came to engage in a space like Kochi, which is conducting like the first, you know, liberal, you know, contemporary art exercise, maybe after liberalization of like after 24 years of liberalization. So we got a plot or a site like that to engage with politics and, you know, discuss about. In fact, even this Kochi also has a kind of an ability to become slowly to, you know, a space for, you know, conflict resolution kind of a thing. I mean, maybe it's a dream, but, you know, there is still that plot. So, you know, while Nandy was also mentioning that the other, you know, how the other comes and engages and, you know, gives you another perspective to that. In fact, I just wanted to kind of throw this also question to kind of invoke. We have some of the artists who are engaging with such kind of a discussion to maybe ask and, you know, like, you know, engage a little bit more further in a context where in the art context, some of the major Indian contemporary argument has always been that how do you reach out to public, you know, with a narrative which is not familiar, because visual art has been like, I mean, like you also pointed out, I mean, before in some of the conversations, like, you know, it's visual art in Kerala is considered as like, I mean, you know, the lowest nomenclature. I mean, you know, it doesn't, you know, appear. So we have kind of broken that and brought in art practices from like, I mean, all across the world to discuss about contemporaneity, which is also taking root from the history. And because there is also parallel, you know, project which is running, like which is digging, you know, a certain, you know, to understand certain kind of realities. So in fact, you know, in the context of art practice in general, like, I mean, as we are artists, like, I mean, we are interested in imagination as a faculty to work. I think this project is also provoking imagination. So that, you know, how, you know, we should look at the contribution which evolves out of, you know, the provocations which happens by, you know, when we operate from a site like this. And I just wanted to also kind of throw this question as a kind of a discourse.
Maybe I can just piggyback on that, because Mr. Madhavan, you seem to suggest that a kind of overt self-consciousness about tolerance, that we are so tolerant and Kochi is such a tolerant city and so forth, somehow spells the death of that form of tolerance. So fuels this kind of mistrust of this awareness or self-consciousness of tolerance? Because if Kochi as a city, let's say, starts to advertise itself as, you know, the epitome of tolerance, you see that as a kind of danger signal, right? Could you elaborate on that? And what are the dangers of this form of self-awareness?
Well, I think it's the disadvantage of being an insider. My main problem is that my experience is slightly different from, I mean, this is a city that has always been looked and narrated and inscribed by outsiders. There have been no history of Kochi written by a Kochianite. I mean, it started from 12th century. Somebody called Nicholas Conti was the first person to write, and down the years it has been written. The rupture happens when, it's almost epiphanic to read the Mr. Professor Nandi's essay, because that throws some sudden flashes. But when you start buying up the Kochianite story, every Kochianite tried to sell the story of tolerance and history, and which is not gelling with reality. It's not the outsider, it's the insider who is trying to mislead. I mean, this is not connected with that. Well, how things are being appropriate. One of the biggest struggles in Kochi was for the Dalits. And Pulayas are a dominant Dalit caste. About 100 years ago, these Pulayas wanted to meet. They were not allowed a meeting ground anywhere in Kochi. So finally what they did was, they joined boats together and had a meeting on the backwater. Now on the 100th anniversary, who but the then Gujarat Chief Minister and the present Prime Minister must come and appropriate this moment. I mean, this is where, you know, when you go easy on history, history gets appropriated. I mean, it gets taken over.
Yes. It's a telling example, I must say.
Dr. Nandy, we were talking about nationalism. My question is that now Narendra Modi is ruling this country. How do you look at it? I mean, how it is going to affect the cosmopolitanism?
Cosmopolitanism.
How is Modi going to affect cosmopolitanism?
Modi's rule. Do you think Modi's rule will affect cosmopolitanism?
No.
No.
As simple as that. Answer is that. I don't expect it. Many others do. Because Indian politics is a great teacher. Indian politician is a great teacher. So it can. But I don't. Because I think he doesn't have the imagination or to think it as simple as that. But the best you can hope is this, that for the sake of his own survival and the hope of getting a second term, that he will, that makes sense to getting a second term. You know, he will try his best to keep his record clean.
Okay.
So I expect that up to a point, some of his sidekicks will play his game, but he will not join it unless and until a crisis sets in and he faces a problem of survival. Then his real self will come.
Thank you.
As simple as that.
Dr. Nandy, please. In your studies, sociological studies, have you ever thought of the ubiquitous role of media in shaping the collective social psyche?
No, I have not really done that. But there is a research group at our center who are interested in that part of the story. And I know it is important. I don't deny that. But me, I have not done it, probably because I have got involved into other things, but me. So we have to depend on others.
Professor Nandy, you made a very interesting remark, which went in passing, was this term Silk Road cosmopolitanism, which then drove me to think of a chapter in your essay that talks of trade as a kind of leveler, the interdependence within the trade amongst communities being a leveler to eradicate a chance of violence. But you also make a side remark, which is really interesting in that chapter, if I recollect, was also the fact that true cosmopolitanism would be formed when trade skills are equally shared across communities. And maybe in the light of what we've just spoken, perhaps you could elaborate the role of trade within this rather complex narrative.
That was my compromise with realism.
But there's also a big shift in trade since the time of your essay to now. I think that the trade landscape has shifted, and perhaps you have another view now of this relationship.
But trade can also cut across other ways. That was the project of even those who would have been natural enemies. That was the project of Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger vis-à-vis China. That was the project of Atal Bihari Vajpayee and Nawaz Sharif. Nawaz Sharif told him point blank, that look, nobody will suspect you of not betraying the national interests of India, and we are Muslim League, we divided India. So no, nobody can doubt our allegiance to Pakistan. Let us finish this Kashmir issue, because this is a drag on the coming generations. So you can get up to a point with that. I am basically a political analyst. I am not an economist. I cannot say whether what will be the exact result of the trade and so on and so forth. What kind of compatibilities there are or not. You will have to ask more qualified people.
As a person who grew up in Kochi, what keeps resonating to me from this talk is what Mr. Madhavan said about the silence that has grown between communities in Kochi. And that is a very real silence. I mean, I'm 25, and in the time that I've grown up, the contact between different communities has drastically reduced. Maybe it's something to do with shifts in trade or economy, but that silence is very real. And I think most of the posturing that we see, what the gentleman over there was talking about, in terms of reasserting religion, has come up to fill this silence. And even as we invoke these cosmopolitan imaginaries of Kochi, as people living here, I think what would be important for us is to go back to this silence and somehow deal with that, you know, think on it. I mean, it's more of a comment.
I'm a psychiatrist. I work in UK, and I work in a place called Bradford, where there are a lot of migrants from Pakistan, probably around the 1950s, who came there because of the mills, and some people from West Indies. There are also a lot of population from the Eastern European side. You know, about the migration which is occurring in Kochi, especially from Bengal. Other parts of India. What I have felt there is that people create a sort of cultural ghettos, and that is actually arising from, one is their own perceived insecurities, the other one which is bestowed on them by the racism, existing racism, which probably is existing within Kochi also. There are also other issues like, you know, identity problems. People who don't wear veils start wearing veils. People who don't read the holy books, holy texts, they start reading it. And then slowly they gravitate into the silence which we are talking about, and they don't communicate. So I have a group of, let's call them patients for the sake, who come with problems which are of cultural origin. And we try to address it in terms of transcultural psychiatry or culturally sensitive psychiatry. That's how we call it. Here also there is a potential problem, which if we don't address it properly, we could have ghettos, which is probably already developing in Perumbavoor and other places, which possibly will result in a lot of internal and external tensions, doubts, suspicions, you know, perceived intolerance or real intolerance. I think it's just an observation which I thought I should tell you, because I have seen people who have come from Bosnia with post-traumatic stress disorder and, you know, various asylum seekers with a lot of problems. And even though they have sought asylum in UK, they still don't become part of the place, because they are still worried about the people who are there, who are trying to support them. Just an observation I thought I'd.
Yeah. Hi. I'm very proud to say that Kerala is the birthplace of Islam, Christianity and Judaism in India. And just in Mattancheri, there are more than 12 communities just nearby here, very happily coexistingly living here. And so, since our topic also to do with the violence, that's our viewpoint on current issue with Israel and Palestine. And in comparison with our response between in Kashmir to Pakistan.
Frankly, these problems will take us, this discussion of these problems fully will take us much beyond the scope of this discussion. I will therefore try to say in one sentence what I, if I had time, developed over more meaningfully. If you look at the maps and if you know the past, remember the past, the British gifted us not only cricket and football, but they also gifted us a partition. And they made the same gift to Palestinians and Israelis and to the Cypriots, the Turks and the Greeks, and to the Irish before everybody else. And it is an indicator of things that all four bled for years. All four bled for years. The arrogance that you can solve the problem between two communities which have been living together for centuries by simply drawing a line on the map would have only come to a colonial power at a point of time when they thought they owned the world. It is not only this partitions, but if you look at the maps of Africa and West Asia, you will also find the same straight lines. As if human beings, their sentiments, their choices, their lifestyles didn't count. But that which is done is very difficult to undo. And even if you undo, it is doubtful whether we can ever go back to the past, because a lot of time has flown by, a lot of things have happened, a lot of blood has flown. So let me answer your question this way, that at least the least we can do, we cannot undo what has been done, but at least we reduce the importance of those borders. If not on ground, at least in our hearts. Because no border exists outside unless and until it is reinforced by borders within our minds. I think our psychiatrist friend there will agree with this. And it is that line we have to defy. We have not done it in adequate way. Particularly our intellectuals have failed us to some extent in that respect.
Thank you, Professor Ashis Nandy. On behalf of everyone, I thank both of you. I think the conversation has thrown a lot of provocative questions, and I hope the discussion continues. Thank you again, sir. Okay.